Thank you so much. Thank you, Misha. And thank you so much for inviting me. And this is wonderful. And I actually want to start with a poem that my sons wrote last year. They're now 7 and 5, but they were then 6 and 4. And it's a prayer for the world, which we need. I don't want sand in my hair, amen. I pray for toys, amen. I pray for God, amen. I pray for the apples and the strawberries, amen. I pray for the birds and the plants, amen. And I pray for the plants to make air, amen. I pray I make myself happy, amen. I pray for shoes and I pray for socks, amen. And the food and the people and the cousins and cupcakes and more people, amen. And I pray for the hiccup, amen. So I'm gonna actually work backwards tonight. I'm gonna read from my forthcoming collection of stories. I am a poet. But I've been writing these stories and sort of hiding these poems inside of them. I'm going to read the title story from my forthcoming collection called Wild Milk. And it's about being a mother and terror, which I think is always the same. Wild Milk. On the first day of Live Oak daycare, all the children are given shovels and a small bag of dirt. We encourage the children, even the babies, especially the babies, to work hard imaginatively. Miss Birdie, my son's teacher, winks. She sits my baby boy in the middle of the floor with his shovel and dirt. He is not even a year old. I look around. The babies are happy. I have never seen such happy babies, chewing on their shovels, spreading around their dirt. Miss Birdie gives me a hug. I wave goodbye to my boy, but he doesn't see me. Go, go, says Miss Birdie. He's in good hands. She shows me her hands. They remind me, for some reason, of my hands. 3 hours later, I come to pick up my boy. He is wearing a bright orange poncho that does not belong to him. He crawls toward me like a searchlight. Your child, says Miss Birdie, is a phenomenon. I blush, oh, thank you. We too think he is very special, I say. I want to ask about the poncho, but Miss Birdie goes on, I mean, your child is a phenomena, says Miss Birdie. What I mean to say is that your child is a real man. Miss Birdie softly pinches her tongue and pulls out a long white hair. Oh, that's better, she says. I mean a ma. She makes little tiny spits. I mean a no one. Your child, says Miss Birdie, is a real no one. No, no, that's not it either. Miss Birdie smooths her stiff cotton skirt. It's pink with tiny red cherries on it. What I mean to say most of all, says Miss Birdie, is that I love not being dead. Me too, I say. Oh, good, says Miss Birdie. Here's his bottle. He drank all his milk and then cried and cried and cried for more. In the hallway, I pass a mother covered in daughters. I count 5. I hold up my bundled son like a form of identification, like he will provide me safe passage across the border. No daughters, she asks. No, I say, no daughters. How come, she asks. She seems to be blaming me unfairly. By the time they arrived, I explain, the daughters had turned. Rotten, she asks. Not exactly rotten, but gigantic. I hand her my boy so I can spread my arms wide to show her how big. I take my boy back. Gigantic, I repeat, and mealy. I sent the whole bin back, the whole bin of daughters back. The brave thing would have been to keep them, I know, but they seem so impossible to name. The mother nods. She still seems to disapprove, but before I can be certain, her daughters lift her up hungrily and carry her away. The strange thing about being a mother is how often I'm interrupted, like something is happening and then something else is happening. It is difficult to get a good grasp on things. The next day, Miss Birdie is peeling vegetables. The babies are watching, transfixed. I have come early to pick up my boy, but I don't see my boy. Miss Birdie points to a child the color of chicken broth. Yours? She asks. Definitely not mine, I say. She points to another and another, as if I lost my ticket for the coat check. I don't see my boy. It is becoming difficult to breathe, and I am suddenly freezing cold. The floor opens up beneath me, and just as I begin to fall through, my boy crawls out from underneath a bassinet. In his fist is a tiny book. On the cover is a picture of a plain brown mouse. He holds it up. Mouse, he says. This is his first real word. My mouse, he says. I am amazed. I am relieved. His pronunciation is perfect. I want to pick him up, reward him with kisses, hold him and never let him go. But Miss Birdie stops me. No, no, she says. She softly wags a finger at my boy. That's not your mouse. That's no one's mouse. Her voice slows. That mouse, Miss Birdie coughs. That mouse, she says, is alone in this world and barely. Miss Birdie stops. What was that? She asks. What was what, I say. That sound, says Miss Birdie. I don't know, I say. What did it sound like? It was a sound that sounded like a sound, says Miss Birdie. Like a sound would make. Never mind. Where was I? You were with the mouse. Oh, the mouse. Do you know him? No, I say, unless you mean, neither do I, says Miss Birdie, and this is my point. That mouse, Miss Birdie is now looking at my boy. That mouse is alone in this world and barely. Miss Birdie sucks in one long, beautiful breath. Exists, says Miss Birdie triumphantly. That mouse is not unlike you. She is still looking at my boy. When I call out for that mouse in the dark, does the mouse come? No, the mouse does not. Do you? So far, not even once. My baby puts his whole hand in Miss Birdie's mouth and leaves it there for what seems like days. On Monday, Miss Birdie's bright pink blouse is fluttering with excitement. Your boy wrote his name today all by himself. She hands me a piece of construction paper. Someone, not my baby, has written on it shreds. I hand the paper back. That is not his name. Oh, says Miss Birdie. She looks at the paper and her face crumples. I'm sorry, says Miss Birdie. I don't know how this happened. I don't know how anything happens, I say. We hold hands. I'm so lonely, says Miss Birdie. I'm so lonely too, I say. I thought you were my hiding place, says Miss Birdie. I picture her skull. I thought you were mine, I say. Miss Birdie ties a yellow scarf around her head. Stop picturing my skull, says Miss Birdie. She is clearly upset. Her lips are cracked and begin to bleed a little. She looks at the construction paper and traces each letter with her thumb. If this isn't his name, then whose name is it? She sorts through the other babies. She pats me down as if searching for something. She touches me on the thigh. She feels like she's about to snow. The next day, there's a message from Miss Birdie. We cannot give your boy his bottle. The milk you left was wild. please bring better milk. I rush to Live Oak, I have no better milk. This is the only milk I have. I point to each breast. Miss Birdie is holding my baby. He is shivering and hungry. Miss Birdie is snowing hard. I try to walk toward her, but there is a great wind and I can barely see through the big white flakes. This is the only milk I have. I am calling to Miss Birdie and my boy through the snowstorm. My arms are outstretched. Come to mama, I cry. I say my baby's name. It sounds smaller and flatter than I ever imagined it. I cannot get to him. Miss Birdie is a blizzard that could last all winter. I am sorry, I am shouting. Miss Birdie has my baby and she is snowing. It is all my fault. I should never have left him. I am sorry. I am sorry. I am sorry. I am punching at the snow. I am fighting against nature when I know I have no choice but to wait until spring. The mother covered in daughters kneels beside me. This time I count 15. Climb on, she says. I am so sorry, I say. It is the only milk I have. Of course it is, she says. Is there room, I ask? Around my neck, she says. I climb up and hang on loosely. The mother covered in daughters is warm, and I am so tired. Go to sleep, says the mother. I will wake you up when it's time to go. But the mother never does wake me up, which is how you know this story is true. So the next piece I'm going to read is called There's a Hole in the Bucket, based on the song There's a Hole in the Bucket. Do you guys know that song? Yes? Okay, good. Sometimes I think about that song being, using that song as a replacement for Happy Birthday. Like, I would actually prefer that song to be sung to me on my birthday. There's a hole in the bucket. I look at the bucket. There is unquestionably a hole. An entire family could live in this hole. I see the hole, I yell, call Mendelssohn. My husband, dear Henry, calls Mendelssohn. Mendelssohn comes right over. We look at the bucket. There is a hole. Mendelssohn studies it. He takes some notes. The southernmost edge of the hole is silent, possibly frozen. The northernmost, rough and forgotten. Mendelssohn sniffs it. Smells like gone, he says, just as I thought. Mendelssohn cups his ear, listens to its center, and jots down a slight trace of harp, the bare cry of a faraway boy. With what shall we, asks dear Henry, fix it? The flower in dear Henry's breast pocket is a pink I've never seen before. Lean close, says Mendelssohn. We lean close. This is going to be a nightmare. Dear Henry and I nod our heads. We know already we will need to fetch the water with a bucket to fix the hole, but we will have no bucket to fetch the water to fix the hole because the bucket with which we would fetch the water has a hole. A white balloon wafts over dear Henry's head. We are failing miserably. With what, asks dear Henry, shall we fix it? He asks again because even though we know how everything ends, the ending remains unimaginable. With straw, says Mendelssohn hopelessly. With straw, I guess, says Mendelssohn again. I look around for straw. Dear Henry opens a can of sardines. He pulls back the tin lid and offers me one. No thanks, I say. Looking for straw, I say. He offers a sardine to Mendelssohn. Why not, shrugs Mendelssohn. Sardines are caught mainly at night, says dear Henry. I know, says Mendelssohn, chewing slowly on the fish. They are caught when they rise to the surface and feed on plankton, says Dear Henry. This is when they're caught, says Dear Henry. They're caught at night when they're the hungriest. I know, says Mendelssohn. Everybody knows, except, I guess, for the sardines, says Dear Henry. Mendelssohn laughs. It's not a joke, says Dear Henry. Sorry, says Mendelssohn. I'm sorry too, says Dear Henry. For what, asks Mendelssohn. Just for everything, says Dear Henry, the bucket and the hole and just everything. Even though I am certain when I find the straw will be too long and I will need to cut the straw with an axe, but the axe will be too dull, and I will need to sharpen the axe with a stone, but the stone will be too dry, and with a hole in the bucket, there is no hope for ever fetching water to wet the stone. I am nevertheless still looking around for straw. This is the song we're in. I hate this bucket. I hate this bucket, I yell. More than the hole, asks Dear Henry. He looks so sad. The hole is the hole that the hole should be. It's the bucket that's destroying us, Dear Henry. It's the bucket. I look at Mendelssohn. I mean, I really look at him. Every day he looks more and more like my mother. With what shall we fix it, Mendelssohn? I am exhausted. How many times can a person ask the same question? Mendelssohn kneels gently beside the bucket and reaches all the way in. His dark, soft curls cover his eyes. Liza, says Dear Henry, grabbing my arm, I think we're dying. With a stone in his hand, Mendelssohn reaches all the way into the bucket, past the hole, past God and summer and almonds and shame and the ocean and mice and love and fevers and worship and snails and teeth and lilac and forgiveness and a song about a bucket with a hole in it, and past the children singing the song, and past their children singing it, and their children's children, and past my broken heart, until he reaches the oldest water and wets the stone. He pulls the stone out and sets it right on top of Dear Henry's head, as if Dear Henry were a tombstone and I've come to his grave to mourn him. The whetstone glistens so brightly, I need to cover my eyes. With what, asks Dear Henry, shall we? I can barely hear him. The song is fading like a song. It is what it is. I remove the whetstone from the top of Dear Henry's head and bury it in my pocket. I notice that the crack shaped like a bucket on Dear Henry's cheek is spreading. There's a hole in that bucket too. I look over at Mendelssohn. He is building a whole entire city out of buckets. There are holes in all of these, says Mendelssohn, who is now covered in holes, under a sky covered in holes, lit by a moon covered in holes, kept by prayers covered in holes. Off in the distance, I can already see the people coming to live in Mendelssohn's city of holes. There are so many people, and they are so beautiful and hopeful, and they too are covered in holes. They each carry a bucket, and in each bucket is a hole. This is the song we're in. One very small, tiny prose poem from my first book, The Babies. And it's about, I think it's about missing everything you love. Box 3, Spool 5. I have a little accordion. I wrap it in brown paper. Tonight, I take it out to the porch and miss you, one word at a time. Lush spiel, I slowly mouth into the dark blue night. Behind me, I can hear me shuffling closer and closer. Be again, be again. I try very hard to pray with all these hands against my back. I miss the keeper of this accordion. I miss the fairgrounds. But most of all, I miss you playing in the 5-cent booth. And I, in my wire gown, and you in your wire gown. Tonight, I unwrap the accordion, and your white hair spills out. Tonight, even you cannot take the place of you. I peel your birthmark from my cheek and toss it to the yard crows. For you to feel their beak marks would be everything. Thank you. Okay, this is it. I like that this one's dog-eared, so I'm gonna read this one. Always dog-eared, the poem calls the mistake. That's the only advice I've ever given, ever. Okay, the mistake. This book, Simsum, has these two characters, Beatrice and Walter B, at their center. And there's another character, the oldest animal, who is often writing letters home to Beatrice and Walter B. throughout the book. This one's called The Mistake. A mistake had been made. Should we shoot it? Asked Walter B. Of course, sighed Beatrice, we should not shoot it. It stood in the long grass and blinked at them. Where do you think, asked Beatrice, it came from? From the debacle, I suppose, is all Walter B. said, and then he considered, or maybe from the babies. Beatrice tugged at her sleeves. A mistake had been made, and now Walter B. and Beatrice had on their hands a situation. How, asked Walter B., do you suppose such a mistake had been made? The mistake began to pose as if it heard him. It staggered across the field. For a moment, it looked like a woman bent over nothing in particular, and then it rose, and then it opened its mouth. Oh, look, exclaimed Beatrice, it's communicating. Is it alone? Whispered Walter B., taking Beatrice's hand. Yes, Beatrice whispered back. I think it is alone, but it was not alone. It was not alone at all. Others began to emerge, some from the trees, some from the grass. Their damp white mouths flashed in the sunlight. Had I known a little ahead of time, said Walter B., I would have changed into my suit. Yes, agreed Beatrice, we should have arrived more prepared. This is exactly what, said Walter B., raising his voice and pointing at the scene in front of them, I had been trying to explain to you, and now we are in a situation without any rope. Pardon me, said Beatrice, and she began to walk into the field, slowly at first, and then faster, and then she began to run. She ran with her arms outstretched, as one might run into a field filled with mothers.
Hello, hello, hello. Good afternoon. Good evening. Good evening. Okay, before I begin, if I may, can I have all of my young scholars to stand up? There we go. I want y'all to please look around. Okay, so we spoke about the importance of passing that word to the next generation, allowing every person in this room have the ability to, or have within them, a poem or a story that can impact, that can inspire, that can change the world. And if we allow the times to selfishly just pull us into ourselves and allow us to just kind of just shun the world, shun our neighbors, shun somebody who don't look like us, then what have we really contributed to the world? So what we do, we have something called a Young Scholars Book Club, where every summer, these young scholars, they are responsible for knocking down or reading, knocking down is like my little code word, knocking down two books. They're responsible for reading two books. And right now, the first book was A Long Way Gone by Ishmael Bey, Memoirs of a Boy Soldier. Yes, intense, right? And the second one is the book called The Hate You Give. And these are what these young scholars are reading. And as they read, we allow them to collectively digest these books. So my challenge to the Athens community is to let's continue to not only inspire our children or your own children that came from your loins, but let's find a way to inspire all of our children. If you're reading a book, maybe get an extra one, another one, and give it to a neighbor. But y'all came to hear poetry, not to hear me speak about all the good things that are happening in the world. If y'all already hear some poetry, say, talk to me. I've heard roaches talk louder than that. If y'all already hear some poetry, say, talk to me. I've heard flies' wings flap louder than that. If y'all already hear some poetry, say, talk to me. In a state of silence is where I do the most communication. In a state of silence is where I do the most communication. First, I align myself with divine truth, converse with the author of my creation. I beg for the seed to feed my dying black nation. Find a cure for the cursed tongues so we can reverse our spiraling degeneration. He laughed. He said, life, it was written that we beheld triumphant in the end. Now modern man communicates through computers, press and send. New habits formed by social network trends. Our voice is no longer used, but we got thousands of social network friends. Freedom of speech as they monitor your email addresses. I'm talking those agencies whose male director was known for wearing female dresses. They implement COINTELPRO, watch our communities regresses. But he or she who's not afraid to speak best believe the Most High blesses. It's sacred geometry. You put a dot within a square, give your room four walls. It's your mind with reverse magic, have it locked inside of laws. The hand that claimed to serve the truth will have you locked within the claws. Program your senses and have you doubting what you saw. Case in point, the kid was given 3 years for selling drugs inside a ballpark, while corporations get richer selling you drugs inside of Walmart. Those surrogate emotions, they sell to you inside of Hallmarks. And if the foundation is built on lies, exit the building before it fall apart. Unmanned drones drop bombs, and I get a ticket for driving a car without a seatbelt. I read to you from what was chiseled in my heart and hoping that it be felt. May it ignite the suns to dry the oceans that we've wept. And may these words open your inner eyes from the centuries that we've slept. I'm warming up. Y'all ready to hear some poetry? You say, talk to me. Now today, you may be upset. I do have a book called Tree of Life, The Human Ascension, which I wrote on a journey, I would say on a journey inward. You know, I graduated from UGA, got my master's, and I was like, yeah, I'm ready to change, inspire the world. I'm a social worker. And somehow the world have a way of changing you, right? And the world have a way of taking that light that we have and putting it in a small box and color it if we allow it to. So I had to take, you know, that's, you know, self-care. I had to travel. I wanted to see the world outside of just what I've been programmed to see and to believe the world as. So I started traveling. I went to Israel. I went to Mexico. I went to Zimbabwe. I went to South Africa. I went all around, just walked. And everywhere I went, I just wrote. I just wrote. And this is what this book, Tree of Life, The Human Ascension, is about. Just me pouring out what I saw, what I felt. Sort of like low poetry is my way of cleaning myself. When the world just pours so much chaos inside of you, poetry is my way of releasing. Some of us box, some of us do push-ups, some of us punch walls. Poetry is my way of releasing. So I say all that to say, y'all gonna hate me for this. I brought the wrong box, so I didn't really have my poetry books. However, I do have my other book. I have my book of short stories. And I think this is a book y'all would also enjoy. But I'll be sure to read one maybe as I get towards the end. You have to warn me. You know I'm long-winded, so you have to warn me. I have all of that inside of here, and so I just keep going. This is for the youth. This is for you all. It's time we stand up, take a pledge for our youth. Reverse the programming that's being wedged in our youth. Confusion is running full-fledged at our youth. Insanity now hang on the edge of our youth. But I tell them freedom is waiting on the ledge for the youth. Corporations bring Santa on a sled for the youth. Reindeers, nose painted red for the youth. Little leprechauns with green feds for the youth. Tooth fairies hiding under beds for the youth. Easter bunnies laying chocolate eggs for the youth. While a pastor is yelling he died and bled for the youth. Pharmacy selling prescription meds to the youth. And rappers sound deals to spit dead to the youth. Verbal genocide, they spit lead to the youth. Load pistols and aim it at the heads of our youth. While parents are unaware of what's being said to the youth. But still consuming the venom that's being spread to the youth. I'm concerned with the lies that's being read to the youth. Synthetic burgers and fries is being fed to the youth. And mama works double shift trying to bring bread to the youth. And fill the shoes of the alpha male who fled from the youth. So when crept the spider, built webs for the youth. They built prisons and jails to be the shed for the youth. Judges slammed gavels, tears shed from the youth. 25 to life, years shed from the youth. While the rest of the world's lapping the head of our youth. When I try to speak sense, it's like they dread in the truth. Listen, become a seamstress for the Most High and thread in the truth. When the valley of death becomes a highway, just trail in the truth. Even if you find yourself alone, at least you dwelled in the truth. Don't be a rebel without a cause. Rebel in the truth. Stare the wicked in their eyes. Tell them the truth. The system is built on lies. They try to sell you the truth and nomenclate your words so they can spell you the truth. But your mind is power. Use your voice to nail in the truth. Be engaged to righteousness. Be wed in the truth. Be protected by the greater light. Be held in the truth. And that's for you. That's for you. That's for all you young people right here. All right? That's for you all. One day you will be on this stage or some stage across this world sharing your poetry, sharing your words. And if you are afraid to write, if you are afraid to express who you are, then that's going to always be your buffer. That's going to prevent you from getting and spreading your words across the truth, across the world. So that, for the youth, was for you all. And some of you, I'm going to tell you, I'm not going to look at you. Please get off of that phone and pay attention right now. Okay? All right, thank you. All right. For the youth. That was for the youth. This one right here is for, I would say... When I talked about me taking that journey, I think this is the poem that triggered and encouraged that journey. And it's called Imitation Life. When the taxes taken from our weekly checks are used to build prisons that incarcerate us, school curriculums that educate us, and pay for the salaries, weapon, and training of police officers that target us, then it is fair for me to conclude that we are financing our own destruction. A degree earned from the prestigious dungeons of Yale and Harvard. Are merely pieces of paper which requires the signatures of only men. Only men. These mortal masters will never expose us of our godly identity, for they possess finite knowledge, finite wisdom, and finite understanding, which they have carefully wrapped under layers of social conditioning, colorfully camouflaged as school spirit. Go Dogs. Athletic altars, gladiator worship, packed coliseums, Greek life and letters that symbolize brotherhood through broken pride. Virgins' innocence ripped when cardinal seeds and beer kegs collide. Drunken frat boys become scholars of our moral authority, and we give them power to enforce policies that dictate how we should raise our children. Mental Holocaust is being committed in class chambers where the souls of students are solicited to corporations that suck dry your humanity through their straw man. Cap and gowns like black hooded robes are worn in public initiations, AKA school graduations, where the new graduates are given degrees as janitorial keys to the Tower of Babel, where each floor is layered with secret handshakes and coded languages to control the perception and behavior of the sleeping mass. But we see clearly the signs of deteriorating times, but still recycle our children through revolving doors of spiritual death, where we encourage them to close the universal portals of infinite knowledge, infinite wisdom, and infinite conscience that guides us through our intuition. But we gladly trade that for a college tuition so that we too can possess expensive cars, elaborate homes, 20 plus years of student loans that fuels the engine of this capitalist system that operates under the premise that money will continue to grow on our family trees. It's like every branch of our sanity is shredded into currency that rotates from paycheck to taxes, taxes to government, government to institution, institution to employers, employers to employees, and where your candle of life melt away or was blown out by the same breath that blew life within you, we leave behind trails of material possessions, wills that divide families, bills that drives us to financial insanity, where we are then prescribed prescription pills to help recover this humanity that we have suffocated with the pillows of imitation life. Life is not our 6 to 12 year degrees that's ingrained in our identity. Life is not our false perception that we have created for ourselves. Life is that voice that peeled back your eyelids to the morning sun. Life is that 2 second vision of clarity piercing through your cloudiest moments. Life is that voice of inspiration that constantly draws you back to your center. Life is, and life will be, once we learn to listen and function at a higher spiritual potential. And sometimes as a poet, you know, it's if I don't write, if I contain all this stuff inside of me, and this is for you, a lot of you young people as well, when you contain all of this anger, you know, like we walk with so much pain, right? And when we release, when we project that pain outwards, it's aggression. And when we project that pain inwards, it's depression. Right? So we have to find outlets for releasing what we feel inside. And I try to do that through writing. And beyond just poetry, I'm also, I teach at the University of Georgia in the School of Social Work. Also, you know, I do a lot of counseling with youth in this community, and I'm the executive director of the Chesson community. But oftentimes I run across issues and situations that really break my heart. And when you know you can't do anything about it, you can't change policies because that would require organization, community organization, and it becomes very tasking. I find poetry I write as ways to release. And this is a poem, more so a story about a young man named Little T that Athens, Georgia. And I hope you all take something from this because, you know, a lot of times we look at Athens as having this split personality or multiple, you know, personality disorder, with so much different energies flowing around Athens, and there are so many communities that are outside of our reach, so many communities that we don't see, that we don't visit, where real issues, real stories are being taken place. And sometimes somebody has to translate the story and not just Athens Banner Herald, you know, that only tell the negative or some positive, a lot of positives as of lately, so no attack against them. This is Little T. Little T was a good kid, but he always wore a mean mug. How many teachers and stuff do you see that little T, right? You see that people walking around, that's that anger that we hold inside that we have to finally release, okay. Little T was a good kid, but he always wore a mean mug. Too much television programmed him to want to be thug. When he's alone, he likes to draw, he likes to read. When he's with his clique, he likes the guns, he likes the... Now you know I was going to say weed. Yeah, it rhymes with weed, right? But lead, he liked the beads, he likes to lead, right? I'm joking, right? When he's alone, he likes to draw, he likes to read. When he's with his clique, he likes the guns, he likes the... The simple presence of his father could have made his world brighter. That desperate yearn for male bonding brought him and his gang tighter. I tried to show him how to weave through this death trap like a spider. And I told him, if you play with fire, you're going to be left broke and empty on the sidewalk like a lighter. He said, life, that's lame talk. He told me the streets never lied. So one of his boys got jumped at a party on the east side. Now it's time to ride. Loyalty and common sense collide. When his gang came to pick them up, he told me he wished he had time to hide. Eventually, every shining sun must face a cloudy day. Too many bad choices are taking our sons away. If you choose to run with wolves, be prepared to feel the scars. Don't end up another soft sheep crying behind bars. Now T riding five deep, still mean mugging to hide his fear. Smoking to calm his nerves down with Chief Keef in his ear. Now he's turned up, his eyes red, his mind is burnt up. All the times we spent talking about peer pressure, but he learned what? If you swarm with killer bees, be prepared to feel the sting. As they let the windows down and let their guns start to sing. Shots fired, kids scattered, some hit the floor. Now little T ain't coming home again until he's 64. Poetry's not always, you know, poetry's not always birds and bees, right? Sometimes it's real issues, and those are ways that we release. We release. Okay, what I want to do, how much more time I got? You know, I'm loaded. I'm okay. I'm going in. I'm in. All right? I want to read a story, a short story from Hidden Ripples, Life's Unspoken Language. And in the Tree of Life, I have so much short stories, and people said, I love your poems, but I love your short stories. All right? So I wanted to read a story. This book is before my father made his transition, he wrote a story, and I was able to at least grab that story from one of my uncles. And my mom, who's still living, she wrote a story called The Seven Dresses. And I think this is the crowd that really would eat up Seven Dresses. So this is a story from my mom. I'm sorry, I have to change the energy a little bit. Right. Seven Dresses. It was a bittersweet day. We just buried my grandmother, who was 96 years old. Looking at her beautiful face, garbed in white, she looked at peace. No stress, no wrinkles, just peaceful. But that's the way she carried herself in life and beyond. The tea kettle started to give a soft, soft, soothing whistle. And the rain was gently hitting the window pane. I walked around looking at her small, humble abode. No TV, just a radio, plants, sofa, table, and a small garden in the backyard. She used to say, if anyone ever broke into my home, once they looked around, they might just leave me something. Jokes. Always jokes. And we'd laugh. Looking into her bedroom takes me back to when I was a child, spending my summers with her. One day, as I looked into a big empty closet, I said, Grandma, where are all your clothes? She said, that's it. Count them for me, Habibi. And I counted all the way to seven. Grandma, you only have seven dresses? Why? Are you poor? She laughed. No, baby. There are 7 days in a week, and I put on a clean dress every day. You may not understand now, but someday you will. I walked into her bedroom and ran my hand across the quilt we made together. On top of the pillows, there was a letter with my name on it. I sat down at the table with two cups of tea and placed one in front of her chair. I could hear her voice as I read my letter. Habibi. I'm not going to pretend to be a grandmother, but I'm not. Habibi. By the time you read this letter, I will already be on my journey. If you look into the closet, the eighth dress on the left-hand side has an envelope with $500,000 in the pocket. Ha! Knew I couldn't fool you. Bet you didn't even get up. Seven dresses. Right. Yes, I still have jokes. By now I'm laughing and crying. Yes, jokes until end. Habibi, let me pass some jewels I live by. You asked me as a child why seven dresses. This is why. Seven dresses kept my life simple. We waste so much time chasing after fads and wanting more and more. More of what we can't afford and don't need. Trying to keep up and getting depressed and in debt when we can't, it's not worth it. When you get something new, give something away. Keep it balanced. I visit young people in the hospital with high blood pressure, diabetes, and heart disease. Why? Because they eat crap, bad diets. If you can't pronounce it or don't grow it, don't eat it. I grow most of my food not just because it's healthier, but when you put your hands in the earth, you connect to it in more than one way. Folks used to call Mr. Jones' son a thug. I didn't. I saw something in that boy's eyes. One day I asked him to move some barrels for me, and we started talking and working the earth together. When he saw those seeds sprouting, you would have thought he won the lottery. He realized what his hands could be used for, and he was a changed man. He'd come every day and wear to weed and water and just stare into the garden, watching it grow. And I was staring at him, watching him grow. I watch him grow years of our best harvest, and we passed it out to our neighborhood. Now they look at him with respect. He's even brought his wife and his son around, got them digging into the earth. She learned how. She too learned how to preserve and to give it to the daycare and community center. Reach one, teach one. His family is an asset to the community. She was planting seeds. See what planting seeds will do. We were rooted together, and you would never know what new seeds will sprout up. Walk, darling. It keeps your mind clear and your body strong. Read, read, read. Read to yourself. Read to your children. Teach them to love books. It can take them anywhere, and they can be anything. Give of yourself. Always be an example of grace and beauty. Listen to nothing, and you'll hear everything. You'll hear the words of the Most High in his creation. How are you going to hear him if you're always plugging into something? Do you think he's going to send you a text? Listen to what people are saying in their eyes. Their eyes say more than their words. Get back to simplicity. Get in touch with yourself. Finally, all these jewels will give you inner joy. Even when you appear to have nothing, you'll have it all. See, I told you I wasn't poor. Well, beloved, it's almost time for me to go. I don't want to be late to my own funeral. Tell Mr. Jones' son to start the community garden. Yes, that's a great idea. Help him out if you can, and keep planting those seeds. He gets it. Habibi, I'm leaving you my tea set in this house. I'll be in touch. Just listen. Much love, Grandma. As the rain fell in her garden, the teardrops fell into my cup. These were not tears of sorrow. No, not sorrow. Tears of joy. I sat thinking about the clutter and the baggage that suffocate my life, and about the peace I craved. I could feel her sitting across me, smiling. She was at peace, and so was I. Just like the seeds she planted and nourished, I too felt a new growth emerging within my shell. As I just sat there and listened, my mother called a few hours later and asked if I was okay. Never better, I said. I'm going home and pick out my 7 dresses. Yes, yes, 7 dresses. So what that book is, it's just my father has a story, my mother has a story, and I have 4 stories, and at the end, all the stories collide into, you know, hidden ripples, life's unspoken language. Last piece. This is a challenge. This is a challenge, not a poem. This is a challenge to the youth. This is a challenge to the adults. We are in some very trying times. A lot of times we watch the things around us, and for some of us, we allow it to take us to bring the worst out of us. And I'm challenging you all to allow what you see around you to bring you into, it's hard for it to bring you to peace, but try your best to not hold all that pain, all that struggle, all that stress inside. This is called a project. Little Abe salutes his comrade and takes a bullet for his project. The kid that squeezed the trigger, he pulled it for his project. Now it's war between the kids and the projects. The city confiscate the land, and corporations bid for the project. Start laying pipelines from the prison to the projects. Flooded with drugs, drain the vision out the project. Put cameras on the posts, wide fence around the projects. But still I seen an empty weed bag laid beneath the bench of the project. On top these kids sit, they're getting high in the projects. Throw the sets up, bandanas fly in the projects. Bullets were exchanged and mothers cry in the project. She said her son was born in a project. He died in a project. They call it social engineering in the projects. Grandma got slapped by her grandson. But no one caring in the project, we take from each other. No more sharing in the projects. These words cry for change, but no one hearing in the projects. Instead, we hear these broke rappers throw knots to make it rain in the projects. And coppers tow Glocks, left a black boy slain in the projects. Where trappers sell rocks, crack grain in the projects. This leaves little Abel as unable. It's too much cane in the projects. Too many grown men mimic little Wayne in the projects. Too many flowers shaking their stems for fame in the projects. Pedophiles walk with no shame in the projects. Dogs roam the streets unchained in the projects. Rip roses from the earth. Young boys are running trains in the projects. And worse, are ministers who claim to be ordained in the projects. Using the Lord's name in vain in the projects. Hustle God with snake tongues and leave spiritual stains in the projects. Come on, 4 churches on 1 block, still nothing gained in the projects. But liquor stores, where they drown out their pain in the projects. Crack house, where they empty out their veins in the projects. Slow genocide. Slow genocide. Slow genocide to nothing remain in the projects. It's bioengineering in the project. Biological warfare is the project. Syphilis in Tuskegee was a project. Bombs dropped on Move in Philly was a project. Chemtrail clouds over our city is a project. Chemtrail clouds over our city is a project. Radiation in the soil is a project. Fill the oceans with oil was a project. Genetic modifying foods is a project. Use frequencies to control your moods is a project. COINTELPRO was a project. The CIA flood the hood with blow it was a project. So crack in the hood was a birth of a nation, even the Klan in white hoods was a project. The prison complex is a project. The housing complex is a project. Now we call all these housing complex the project. But it's a new day. Let old scars peel from the projects. We want change. We gotta wanna deal with our projects. Correct those that rob, rape, and steal in our projects. And those that hustle white death to kill a zeal in our projects. My father said, young boy, your hand is a deadly weapon, but could also be used to heal our projects. Plant good seeds, watch the harvest yield in the projects. Learn to utilize the parks and the fields in our projects. Take back control. We got to wield our project. Turn every man into an armor and a shield for the project. It's warfare. Become a righteous seal for the project. Aim high. Push the moral will of the project. If humanity is beautiful, then let it be revealed in our projects. Let's start by giving back the lies and focus on what's real in our projects, like grow food so we provide the meal for the projects, eat healthy to eradicate the ills in our projects, natural herbs in place of dietary pills in our projects, try 3 days a week without salt as your project. Bring your sugar intake to a halt as a project. Fast 2 weeks off Facebook as a project. And put you and your child's face inside a book as a project. Let's teach our sons chess and karate in a Let's teach our daughter self-esteem and Pilates in a Take the television off, read more in the projects. Open up your mind, see more than a project. Don't settle for a cell, be more than a Don't settle for a gel, be more than a Don't settle for your cells, be more than a Thank you all so much. Thank you all so much.
Here, this is not over. We want to invite both poets, please, back up to the stage. Give them the warmest round of applause. We're going to ask you some questions. Can you come back, both of you, Sabrina and Life? Can you come? So this is the time. Oh, Sharon's here. Sharon's reading next week. Woo!
Woo! Woo! Woo!
This is the time when everyone here, poetry is sometimes this elusive thing. We don't know if we're a part of it or connected to it. And we have two very accomplished writers and people in our universe, in our hometown. And this is when you get to ask any question to these writers about anything you heard or want to know or just to be in community together. So I want to invite first the great Charlie King, who is with us tonight. Come on up, Charlie.
Yeah.
She has some, we have some gifts for you guys for coming.
Thank you.
And for this is for your sweet tea to keep your thirst going.
Yes, thank you.
And an honorary gift from our town's Commission on the Arts. Thank you so much, you guys. That was really awesome. So I guess, what are you thinking about? Have at it. Ask these guys a question.
And that goes to you too as well, young scholars. Y'all have questions, please ask. And now everybody at once, please.
I'm gonna step down. You guys got it.
And you want us to repeat the question?
Oh,
okay.
Yes.
Please repeat the question.
Okay.
What do you think of the statement, you are what you walk in between?
What was the question?
He asked the question, what do you think of the statement, you are what you walk in between? I think that's, I mean, for both of us, I speak a lot in poetry, but also in my classes about programming and the importance of programming, conditioning and programming. And oftentimes our narrative, the way we see ourselves is also all usually shaped through someone else's narrative. So the idea for me, you are what you walk in between, it speaks a lot to our programming. It speaks a lot to what we have experienced that shaped us into who we are. And let me not get long-winded. That's what I believe.
I love that question. I love the idea of the in-between spaces and the liminal spaces. And I think I think one job as a writer, as a teacher, is to sort of like hold your ear to the cracks in the walls, and like listen into those spaces. I know, like you mentioned, you had been to Israel, and I was in Israel recently, and I tried to get to the Western Wall, to where you like put your prayer, in the cracks in the wall. And I couldn't get to it because it was so crowded, and then my button on my sweater got snagged on an old lady's sweater and I had to turn around and go back. But
that's
a different story. Right.
That's
but I love the idea of sort of like those liminal spaces, those quiet spaces, those in-between spaces. And I think like, you know, if you listen to those spaces, to those in-between spaces, and you put your, you know, you put your prayers in those spaces, there is tremendous power in that. I often think like that's the real job of poetry, right? Is to sort of articulate the silences. So.
You think so?
Well, this is a little bit more for Sabrina, sorry. But for you as well, like, so when you're writing your poems that are a little less clear as far as their message goes, what's important to you to think about as you think about your reader and their perception of your poem? Like, how do you decide?
It's interesting because I had someone. I'm sorry. The question was, you know, there's that question of clarity in a poem, right? Like, how do you decide like how direct your message is going to be? Is that fair? It's funny because I had given a reading at Wells College a few months ago, and somebody had asked a very similar question, and she said, do you mean to make no sense? Or it was that, right? And then, I think that there was that sense of like, you know, oh no, I don't mean to offend you, but do you make no sense. But I think that there, you know, I think we move through the world with this sense that language needs to operate in one particular way, right? Like it's sort of, I mean, we learn to commodify language where you're like, okay, you know, language is used as a way to direct, right? To say like, where do I go? How do I get this thing? Like, where's the bus stop? You know, when? And then there's this like other language. And I try to work in the realm of both those languages, but I love that other language where it's the language that turns the volume up on the emotional landscape, right? So it's the language that will speak towards a kind of like inner landscape that in other spaces we don't really get to talk about, we don't really get to articulate. There's that idea, I think it's the same with your poetry also, like even though I think our poetry is very different in many ways, like we're sharing, I think, the desire to speak the thing that keeps not being spoken, right? Like find shape and form for what isn't spoken,
yeah.
Right?
Well, I agree completely. And it comes to the story behind the poem, because oftentimes, what was the experience that triggered you to write a poem? And oftentimes for me, it's you share that experience, and sometimes it could be so coded into a way that you understand exactly what it is, what the message, but you write it in a way for each reader to read it, and they translate it the way they get from it what it is that they need to get from it. So I do have poetry that goes like, it's so coded, and oftentimes kids are gonna be like, what are you talking? Like, I have no idea what you're talking about. So for me, I think what I try to do is I try to write and bring another generation into poetry and bring one layer and then allow them to start thinking in personifications and all these things we learn about in poetry. And some of my earliest kind of inspiration for poetry, it wasn't, you know, like Shakespeare and Hamlet. It wasn't, It was more Khalil Gibran, it was more Rumi, it was more learning about poetry through a Middle Eastern lens, learning about poetry through more, you know, Asian writers. And I was able to just kind of grab some of that. And then when I learned about Hamlet, it was like, man, let me digest this. First of all, I need to learn the language better and really learn how to read it. And I think I like to believe that it's a lot of people who see poetry and say, I'm not with that poetry stuff. That, you know, but it's so much, it's so hidden, there's so many details to it. And I think it's the educated really understand it, because you can dig deeper into it, whereas the average is looking at it like, I'm not trying to climb that ivory tower to understand and to digest this. But that is the beauty of poetry, when you're able to see something and just dig deeper and deeper. And I would challenge you, write for how you need to release, but also, for me, you put something in there that can help the reader get something from it. Even if they got one line and they digest that one line, and that one line inspired them to write, and that becomes a topic for a poem they write. Whatever the case may be, you find that lens, you find that channel. So, yeah. Yes.
So, I was so moved by what you said, that pain externals anger, pain internals depression, and we need an outlet for expression. So working with your scholars, could you kind of talk me through that process as you've used with the youth to help define that voice?
She said the statement that I made about pain internally is depression, pain externally is aggression, and we have to find outlets for helping people. Just she's pretty much asking, what are those outlets that could be used that I'm using with the scholars to help, you know, help them release that their pain? And you know, the book club. You know, we have a book club, and I think oftentimes, as you begin to read other people's pain, like I might believe that I have the worst life ever until I read the life of what Ishmael Bey went through. A long way gone, he was a child soldier. I may believe that, you know, what the things that I'm going through is completely, you know, it breaks me, you know. So what I, with the scholars, some of them, a lot of them interact. I mean, it's a different generation. So where do I like to start when I'm teaching, getting youth to express? I like to start from where they're at, not from where I'm at, right? So when I start from where they're at, what are your favorite music? Who's your favorite artist? All right? Now give me a line from your favorite artist that really moves you. Right? Now from that, I want you to begin to write something how you're similar, something you're going through is similar to what this person and what this line, like draw me something similar. And you know, sometimes, you know, it gets into some of the cussing. I'm on. Okay. Now I want you to do that without cussing. Let's find another word. Let's find another, you know, another adjective. Let's find another a way to express. So I use writing, and this is not, I don't do this with scholars. I do this as more when I'm doing counseling with youth who are really going through extreme severe issues. I start with there with the music. And others, what we do is we just play chess and we talk mess to each other. So that's what I do with some of the scholars. But I start from where they're at with the music preference that they enjoy. And when I read a poem, or let's say a poet, then I introduce them to that poem and allow them to read it. And I say, you see how this person released their pain. Now I challenge them to write something similar. You don't have to, it don't have to be scholarly, just write something. Just write. And then introduce them to new vocabularies. Now I want you to look through the dictionary, find 10 words that match with this, and this. And then from there, challenge them, you know, the thesaurus, you know, challenge them to start expressing. Because oftentimes, when people don't know how to express themselves, people only know how to express themselves through their anger. I'm angry, and I'm going to express myself the way I know how to, and that's to hit something, that's to be. And when I don't have the vocabulary to express what's going on inside, then I release it other ways. So teaching them to expand the vocabulary and to express it. You're angry, talk about what's going on. And I start with my son, talk about what's happening. He gets mad, what you angry about? Talk about it clearly. Look at me, unball your fists, look at me, now speak. You know, what are you trying to say? So I just find, help them to find words to express them. And this is what I use at the YDCs, the youth detention centers, to help those kids find a language to express who they are and what they are and that pain that they're walking through. And when they do, then it becomes a lot easier to communicate. And that's to the heart of what it is we do with that, using words to express the pain. Because I'm long-winded.
I mean, I believe that, you know...
Oh, what's the question?
Okay. Does practice make improvement, or is poetry... does practice make... Improvement? Okay. Or is the poetry...
Inside of you.
Inside of us. I mean, you know, I think that... There are stories. I love what you just said, by the way, about, you know, this idea that, like, stories and poetry hold us up. I really believe that there are stories everywhere. I mean, they're in the air, right? Like, you can feel them, and they're not fully realized, and you have to be open to receive them. And to be open to receive them means to be open to receive them. Like, you have to be there. You have to sort of move through the world. I think do the work. I mean, I believe in talent a little bit, maybe like 3%. But like the rest of it is just, it's like being open and doing the work and listening and reading. And poetry and stories, that's the history of human emotion. Like, the more you bring in to your body, I think the better writer you're going to be. I always tell my students just to like read everything. You listen to all the stories. You just listen to all the stories.
I would say now I also say, I say both, right? Because it's when you write, you ask yourself, what are you writing for? If you're saying, I'm writing so that I can share that with the world, you know, some people write to release. When I used to write, I started writing to my brother who was incarcerated. He was doing 15 years. He was 15 years old. He went inside for something. And I saw him growing through different things. So he would just write, and I would just write what I felt, what I saw, and I would, at the time, I didn't call it poetry. He was like, man, I'm letting people in here read it, and they really are moved by those words. You need to start sharing that. You need to start sharing it with others. But I would say, man, I can't say, white people want to understand what I'm going through, or, you know what I mean, these type of people want to understand. But it's like, no, you know, it's, you write what's inside of you, and the reader, the listener will, you know, get what it is that they need. Now, the practice, I couldn't just say I come up here and just off the top. That takes practice, right? And I remember being
By the way, I'm totally in awe of that. There's like no way. I would stand here and just stare at you all.
But that takes a great level of practice, because with me, it's like I see it. It's written inside. And it's like I see it. My family is artists. Like, my cousins are artists. My brothers, my sister, all of them draw very well. My father can play piano by ear. I love music. I hear music. I see these things in my mind. I can't draw to save my life. So what I try to do is I try to draw words, right? So I just see what I see. I try to find a way to release that into words. That's what comes inside of you. The other part is the practice. I remember a gentleman, I remember when I thought I was deep, my brother told me, they really inspire you. So I was like feeling myself. I was really, I'm nice. And I remember going to doing some reading, And I saw this one guy, he got up on the stage and I saw, you know, Saul Williams, and I was just like, wow. And one advice that a gentleman told me, he said, read more work. You have to read more. You have to read other work. You have to be inspired by, you know, not just from what you're comfortable with, read others. And the more I read, you know, I just, you know, it moves me into writing something. But there are poems that I write for me, that this is for my children's children's children. And there are other poetry that I write and share with the world. So I think both. You know, there's no improvement. I like to say ivory walls, you know. I try not to box poetry, right? Like people say, okay, poetry needs to fit like this and look like this and sound like this. And for a new generation of kids, it's like the same way if you sit here, you're like, I have no idea what the song is talking about. But the kids can hear it and it makes perfect sense. The same way when you go up and start reading poetry, this is what they hear. They're like, you know, so I try to, we have to find a way to bring poetry to another generation. And that means to break all rules. For me, to break all rules, you know, just come at it, be raw, spoken word, just bring it. So in that sense, who's going to say what you're writing is not poetry? You know, so whatever you got inside of you, release it, you know.
Books and ask them questions when they're sitting signing your book.
Yes.
You read more. Does that sound good?
Yes, yes. But you get one more.
One
if you
more,
want.
One
if you
more,
want.
One
it's okay.
More,
I'm sorry.
One more.
I think this will work for you, Misha.
All right.
I have one more question as a writer because I have two of my favorite poets up on stage.
Wow.
Yeah.
How much, for both of you, how much of your writing time is intentional versus how much of it just comes over you and you have to drop everything because you know what's in your head and it has to get on paper?
I'm long-winded. You want me to take it first?
Go ahead.
Okay, it's, wow. I mean, that is a, you know, it's like, oh, so it's a poetry. It, when it comes, it don't warn you, right? It comes. There are poems, like the project poem, you know. If I didn't stop it, it would have kept going. But I know the attention span of people were very, you know, 6 seconds, you know, goldfish mind, you know. And that poem would probably go 30 minutes strong. Because when it comes, it comes. It just pours through. Khalil Gibran said about our children, they come through us, not from us. And I like to look at that as poetry as well. It comes through us, not from us. So there are times when it's like, okay, and I don't even have time to write no more. So I have to, as I'm driving, I'm writing my mind. And when it's completed, then it's when I say, okay, let me put this in paper. And I just write and write and write. So, and there are other times when I'm sleeping and you just wake up and it's like, let me take time to write. Because I tell my wife all the time, I have to write, I have to read more. And when you're on the ground, when you're doing all the work that we're doing, we got to find time to read. Who said it? If I had more time, I would write less, right? Mark Twain said that. If I had more time, I would write less. So it's like, you know, I have to find time to more read more work material, read other people's stuff as a way to just kind of like, I love the way she used these concepts. I love the way she bent these words, and that inspired me to do more. And other times, when it comes, it just comes, and you have to listen to the poem.
I wake up at 5 in the morning. I wake up, for a long time, I was waking up at 4:44 every morning because I knew my kids wouldn't be up. And I knew that I could have like at least like 2 hours. I used to work on the other end of that, you know, where I would stay up all night and work before I had kids. But I love those hours where it feels like everybody's fast asleep, like, it's, you know, it's those like witching hours spaces. And then what I've done is when I do wake up, because I do wake up very, very early and I do the writing, almost before, like I'm half awake almost, throughout, it opens me up for the rest of the day. But I wish I was a person who could stop everything I was doing to write. I mean, I always carry around notebooks and sometimes like I'll scribble, you know, like I'm always like scribbling things down through the day, but the real work is like, has to be when everybody is
agree.
Yeah.
I agree. And if I can just say one more, we have to use your recorder, right? Because sometimes I just get in and I'm like, ooh, I got it like this. And I just use the recorder, and then later, the thought, I just say it, and then I go home and I just see if I can still be in that space, and I just write from that space. So take advantage of the recorders and everything.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
So wonderful.